Hello everybody, welcome to Word Shard.
Today we are going to start with The Merchant of Venice. It is a play which is written by William Shakespeare. It is mainly for the ICSE students, class 9s and class 10s, who are going to appear and opt for this drama, The Merchant of Venice. We are going to start with Act 1, but before we start, I'll give you a small two-liners so that you are introduced well with the play. See, William Shakespeare was a playwright and also a sonnet writer. He wrote a number of poems and also a huge number of plays. Okay, so this play is both a comedy as well as a tragedy. You know, he wrote two types of plays mainly. One was the tragedy, which had a sad ending, and the other was a comedy, which you can understand very well that it always ends with a happy ending. But there are few plays which are a combination of both of them. That means happiness and sadness. It is a mix of both, mix and match of both. So that kind of a play is The Merchant of Venice. It is therefore called the tragi-comedy. Okay. So now the scene begins. The opening scene is set in a street of Venice. You know, Venice is a place, name of a place, and it starts at a street of Venice. Antonio is one of the main characters of the story, and he is a very wealthy merchant of Venice, and his two friends, we also meet his two friends, Salarino and Salino. They are communicating, they are talking with one another, and you will meet some of the other important characters also. Now, see Act 1, Scene 1. It is already written, Venice, a street. So, where does this scene takes place? A question can come like this. You have to say that it is a street in Venice. See, who are the characters? These questions are very important. 1 mark, 2 mark questions can come from here. Who are the characters who are there in Act 1, Scene 1? Okay, when they were talking with one another. Who were those people? They were Antonio, Salarino, Solano. So, you have to remember the names. First, Antonio. In sooth, see all the words which are difficult are written in red. The meanings of the words are written in red. You can write them down in your book if you want. In sooth means honestly. I know not why I am so sad. See, Antonio is a person who always has a very sad mood. Okay, holds on to a sad mood. Always very sad in his appearance. So, his friends are worried. When you are sad, your friends, your parents have become worried, isn't it? Similarly, when Antonio meets his friends are also worried that why Antonio is so sad. So Antonio replies to them, in sooth, that means honestly, I know not why I am so sad. He is not aware of the reason that why he is sad. It varies. You already know what is the meaning of varies. It means tired. I am very tired of this kind of behavior of mine. Why I am so sad, I don't know. You say it varies you. Obviously, your friends will also be worried if you are sad, isn't it? But how I caught it, found it, or came by it, what is the word? What do you mean by it? It means the sadness. He is always so sad. Now, when his friends ask him, why are you sad? He cannot give a proper answer. He says, I myself do not know the reason behind my sorrow. What stuff it is made of? What stuff it is made of means, I do not know the reason for my sadness. I don't know what happened that made me sad. Whereof it is born, from where I got this sadness, what was the reason behind it? I am to learn, which means, I do not know yet. I am yet to know that, know the reason behind my sadness. And such a want which sadness makes of me, that I have much ado to know myself. Such a want which sadness makes of me. That means as I do not know the reason behind my sadness, it is also very difficult to know my own self. I don't know my own self because I don't even know why I am sad. It's just a normal behavior of mine. I cannot understand the reason behind my sadness. So just to summarize this part, this sadness makes me so absent-minded. So if I am sad, I will be absent-minded. I cannot enjoy with my friends. So I am very absent-minded, Antonio says, that it becomes very difficult for me to understand myself. I cannot understand my own self. I am absent-minded. I am sad. And that makes me tired of my own self. Okay. Next, Salarino. Now, Salarino is the other character. are the friend of Antonio. Your mind is tossing. Tossing means is rolling on the ocean. Be very careful in this part. These parts are very important. According to Salerino, the reason behind Antonio's sadness is this, that he is very worried. He is a businessman. Antonio is a merchant. Okay, his ships. He's a person whose goods are on the ship. And you know, in the earlier days, they used to carry they had ships, and the ships used to carry all the goods from one place to the other. So Antonio was the producer, and he used to send these goods to the other places by a ship, transported by a ship. So your ship can get into a lot of risk while it is traveling in the ocean, isn't it? There can be storms, there can be sand dunes which it can hit, isn't it? So his mind is tossing on the ocean. That means you are constantly worried about the risks that your ships can undergo. Your ships can meet a number of dangers in the sea. That is why you are worried about your business. There were your argosies. Argosies means the big commercial ships. These ships are owned by whom? By Antonio. These are Antonio's ships. Antonio is a very wealthy merchant. I have already told you. He had a number of ships. All those ships are carrying his goods to different other places to sell them. So if the ships get shipwrecked, or if any other thing, bad things happen to the ship, if there is a shipwreck or if it goes anywhere else instead of coming back, then what will happen? Antonio will be suffering a huge loss. That is why he is worried, according to Salerino, with portly sail. So according to Salerino, the ships of Antonio are huge in size and they have portly sail. They have huge sails. What do you mean by sails? See, I have a picture for you, so that it is easier for you to understand. These were the ships which were used many years back. These were the sails. This were used to utilize the wind force so that the ships can move. Okay. If the sails were out, if the wind force was this way, then the ship could move in the forward direction. So these sails were used for the movement of the ship. Now, the ships of Antonio had huge sails. They were big ships. Big ships will have big sails. So Antonio's ships were huge in size. They had huge sails and a huge number of sails. Okay. Like sinners. Sinners means gentlemen, and rich borders, important citizens on the flood. On the flood means sea. So it means that Antonio's ships were quite like the, you know, very important personalities, very important citizens, maybe like the prime minister, the chief minister, the king. Okay, just like them, they are very important citizens of the country on the sea, moving on the flood. That means moving on the sea. His ships were so big that it appeared like important persons walking on the sea. Okay. Or as it were, the pageants of the sea. Pageants means as if it was a procession on the sea. When the ships of Antonio used to move, it seemed that an important person is moving. Okay, like when a chief minister goes, a number of cars follow behind it, isn't it? It is a very rich person, somebody very rich or somebody very renowned, like Shah Rukh Khan or any other personality. If they walk, then a huge number of people follow. So it was quite like a procession in the sea when Antonio's wealthy ships used to move. Do overpeer the petty traffickers. Overpeer means, obviously, Antonio's big ships were far better looking and grand than the petty traffickers. Petty traffickers means the smaller ships, the smaller businessmen used to have smaller ships, smaller sails. So when they passed by the side of Antonio's ship, they seemed very small in size. Beside this huge ship, if there is a small ship passing by, obviously it will look very small in front of Antonio's ship. So they appeared petty traffickers, smaller ones, that curtsy to them. It seemed that these small ships were bending their heads and showing curtsy to Antonio's big ships. Okay, do them reverence, that means show respect, as they fly by them with their woven wings. It seems that Antonio's ships, the sails of Antonio's ships, were like birds, big birds moving in the sky. And the other smaller ships that passed by Antonio's ship, they bent their heads down so that they could show respect to Antonio. Okay, to Antonio's ships. Next, Salerno. Believe me, sir, had I such venture forth. So Salerno says that Believe me, if I had such business tensions, if so many ships of mine were in the sea and they could endure risk at any moment, okay, then the better part of my affections, that means most of my thoughts, would be still with my hopes abroad. I would be busy thinking about them. I would be constantly thinking about the risks that it could undergo. I should be still plucking the grass to know where sits the wind. So I would always be worried about my ships. And what would I do? I would constantly worry and I would be tossing blades of grass into the air to find out which way the wind was blowing. So that you can understand it better, I have a picture which will make you understand better. See, when you hold a piece of grass in your hand and lift it to the sky, what happens is if a wind is blowing, you can understand the direction of the wind. As in this picture, you can understand the wind direction is this way. Okay, so previously the ships had to depend a lot on the wind, isn't it? That is the reason why they had those big sails made of cloth. So they had to depend on the wind. If there was a storm, then you can understand that the ships would undergo a huge amount of damage. There could be shipwrecks easily. That is why to understand which direction, in which direction the wind was blowing, if it was favorable for the ships, he would constantly pluck the grass and check which side the wind is blowing. What else would he do? Peering into maps for ports and piers. Peering means he would constantly look into maps, okay, to check. Where are the ports? Where are the harbors? Piers means harbors. Where are the harbors? Where are the roads? Roads means the proper way for the ship. If there is no proper way for the ship, if there is perhaps an iceberg in the middle, or if there is a half submerged stone like you saw in the Titanic, then it would be a danger for the ship, isn't it? So he would be constantly worrying about all that. And every object that might make me fear misfortune to my ventures. So I would constantly worry when I see something, I think when I see a storm approaching, I'm afraid that my ships can just, there can be a shipwreck. When I see this, I fear about that. When I see that, I fear about that. All the time, I'm thinking about my ships and its risks. Out of doubt would make me sad. Out of doubt means out of fear. Out of fear of all that risk, I would always be sad and depressed, just like you. Next, Salarino. Now, Salarino goes on talking about few other things that would make him worry. What are those? See, he says, my wind cooling my broth. What do you mean by wind cooling my broth? See, broth means soup. Sometimes when you are given a very hot soup, okay, what do? You blow on it, isn't it? Just like this girl is doing, you blow on the soup so that it cools down a bit and then you can have it. So when you blow on it, next time check what happens to that surface of water or the surface of the soup. You know, there are kind of ripples formed, isn't it, when you blow on the soup. Now, if God was blowing on the sea, if there was a storm, that means if there was a storm on the sea, then what would happen? What would that wind, how would that wind affect the ships on the sea? There could be a shipwreck. So that thought, whenever I am given a soup, a hot soup, and I am blowing on the soup, I think about that, and that would blow me to an ague. To an ague means when you have a lot of fever, you tremble, you shake, and I would be shaking at that fear that immediately, it would immediately come to my mind that okay, now a storm, if a storm comes and attacks my ships, then all my ships will undergo shipwrecks. And then I would be completely lost. I thought, what harm a wind too great at sea might do? So when I am given a soup and I am blowing on it, I suddenly start thinking that a storm, a wind, a huge storm can cause a lot of damage to my ships. Next, we'll move to the next thought. What does he think? I should not see the sandy hourglass run. What is a sandy hourglass? See, this was the thing utilized in the past to measure time. It indicated time. So there is sand over here. This part of the sand was dropped to the lower part to identify how much time has passed, to indicate time. So whenever I see this, this is called an hourglass. Whenever I saw this hourglass, I started thinking about the shallows and of flats. I started thinking about shallows. Shallows means shallow water and of flats. Then every time He used to glance at the sand in the hourglass. He would imagine his ships wrecked on the sandbars. Okay, it would give him a lot of, give him a lot of trouble in thinking about all that whenever he saw the hourglass, the sand in the hourglass, the harm the sand could cause to the ships. If the ship got stuck in the shallow waters or in the sandbanks, then what would happen? The wealthy Andrew, what is Andrew? Andrew is the name of the ship. Then his wealthy Andrew would be docked, would be stuck in that sand, and slowly it would be pulled down inside the sand. Okay, failing her high top, that means the top of the ship, the mast of the ship. Mast is the wooden pieces which is attached to the sails. So that top part of the ship would slowly sink downwards and lower than the ribs. That means even the side would go lower and lower to kiss his burial. That means slowly my ship would get stuck inside the sand, deep inside the sand. Okay. Next, we'll move to the next thought. Should I go to church and see the holy edifice? Edifice means building of stone. See, when you go to the church, mainly the Christians, when they go to the church, they seek peace over there. They search for peace when they go to the church, isn't it? For peace only, they'll visit that place. But when he goes there and sees the stone walls of the church, it reminds him of the rocks, the dangerous rocks that could cause a lot of damage to his ships. If his ship brushed up against these rocks, then what would happen? The whole cargo of spices would be strewn in the water. But my gentle vessel side, if my gentle vessel means if my ship touched those dangerous rocks, then what would happen? The ship would break down and all her spices, that means the ship was carrying spices, would be thrown into the water, enrobe the roaring waters with my silk. That means the ship was also carrying silks. All my silk would be all over the water of the sea and in a word, but even now worth this and now worth nothing. That means if the ship came back to him, then he could earn a lot of money by selling the silk and the spices. But if there is a shipwreck, then what would happen? All his spices and silk would be into the water and he would not profit from the ships. There would be loss upon loss. Shall I have the thought to think on this? Shall I lack the thought that such a thing bechance? Bechance means if such a thing happens, then that would obviously make me sad. If I have to think that any moment my ship can undergo a shipwreck, then obviously that will make me sad and depressed and afraid. So this is a summary of what you have just studied. He talks about the rocks he used to make the church walls. He goes there for peace, but as soon as he sees the walls, he becomes afraid as the rock reminds him of the dangerous icebergs or the rocks in the sea. You saw in the Titanic, it just touched the iceberg, it just touched the rock and it shattered into pieces. Isn't it? So his ship would also be destroyed and all his commodities, all his cargo in the ship would also be destroyed. So it would be a loss. But tell not me, I know Antonio is sad to think upon his merchandise. Merchandise means the cargo in the ship, what the ship is carrying for sale. So Antonio, he realizes and he says also that Antonio is sad because Antonio is depressed and afraid because he's constantly worrying about his ships. Okay, I think this part is clear. Next, Antonio, believe me, no, I thank my fortune. So Antonio says that no, that is not the truth. He is not worried about the ships. I thank my fortune. That means his financial condition. His financial condition is quite well. And my ventures are not in one bottom trusted. That means he has not invested or spent all his money on the goods that is carried by one ship. Okay. So he does not have all of his money invested in one ship or one part of the world. That means not to one place, which means it is not that one of the ship which is going to one particular place and all of his money is stacked on that. He has invested all money on that ship only. No, he is quite rich and he has other ships going to other places also. Nor is my whole estate upon the fortune of this present year. And it is also true that if he doesn't do well this year, then he will still be okay. It would still be okay for him. He has a lot of money in store. It is not that all of his fortune depends in this business only. Okay, it depends in this year's business. He has a lot of money in store also. Therefore, my merchandise makes me not sad. Therefore, it is my business or the troubles in my business is not the reason for this sadness. Salarino, why then you are in love? Okay, then it might be so that you have fallen in love. That is why you are kind of depressed. Fie, Antonio says, no, that is not the case. Salarino, not in love neither. Then let us say you are sad because you are not merry. Okay, then I have to think that you are sad because you are not merry. You know, it does not mean that you have to show your happiness by jumping and laughing and doing whatnot. You can just be quiet. It does not mean that you are sad, isn't it? If you are sitting quietly, it does not mean that you are sad. It may mean that, okay, you don't want to jump around, but fine, you are not sad also. So, and it were as easy for you to laugh and leap and say you are merry because you are not sad. Some people are there who would laugh whenever they are happy. They would laugh, jump, and they would party and do whatnot. But few people are like this also. When they are happy, they will just sit quietly. They do not go to party or they do not jump and laugh and do whatnot, isn't it? There are different behaviors of different people. Now, by two-headed Janus. Who is Janus? The Roman god of doors with two faces, one angry and one smiling. See, this is the Roman god. I have a picture for you. It is placed in front of the door. One side of it smiles and the other face is frowning. That means it is always angry. There are two faces of the god, and that is also quite strange, isn't it? Normally we have only one head, but this god has two heads. So nature has created strange fellows in her time. Nature has strange creatures like this god who has two heads. There are people who behave differently when they're happy or when they're sad, isn't it? Some, now he goes on describing how they can be different. Some that will evermore, that means always, peep through their eyes. Peep through their eyes, and when you laugh a lot, when you laugh like this, see this emoji. When you laugh a lot, your eyes become small as if you have to peep through it. And laugh like parrots as at a bagpiper. Bagpiper is a person who, bagpipe is an instrument, wind instrument, musical instrument. So there is nothing to laugh when a bagpiper is playing, but they find that one also funny. So they laugh like this and their eyes become small as they laugh so much. Okay. But there are also a few other people who have vinegar aspect. That means when you just try to put some vinegar on your tongue and check how your face becomes, it is very, you'll have a sour expression. Okay. So there are few people who will never show their teeth in a way of smile. They will never smile. Whatever might be the joke, however funny the joke might be, they will never laugh. Their face will always be like this. Okay. Though Nestor, Nestor means, who is this Nestor? Nestor means the old wise Greek general who fought in the Trojan War. Who is Nestor? Nestor is a very wise person. And even when this wise general tells you, okay, such a wise person like Nestor tells you that, see, the joke is laughable. Swear the jest. Jest means the joke is laughable. Even when he tells you that the joke is laughable, that person will never laugh. He will always have a face like this. Okay. That is the difference between these two people. So people have different natures. They behave in a different way. So Antonio can just be that strange manner, can hold on to that strange manner. There is nothing, there is no problem in that. Okay. Now enter Bassanio, Lorenzo and Cristiano. Now three of his friends enter. Three of Antonio's friends. These are newer characters and important characters. Okay. Salenio. Here comes Bassanio, your most noble kinsman. That means Salenio says that Bassanio is the best friend of Antonio. See, your best friend has come along with Cristiano and Lorenzo. Fare you well, that means goodbye. We leave you now with better company. That means we are leaving you here with better friends, with closer friends. Salarino, I would have stayed till I had made you merry. Okay, I would have stayed back so that I could just help you to lift your mood. But worthier friends have come. Worthier friends have not prevented me. That means your closer friends, your best friend is here. So you don't need me anymore. Antonio, your worth is very dear in my regard. See, you are a very important person in my life. You are no lesser than a senior or anybody else. I take it, that means I understand that your own business calls. You must have some work, that is why you have to depart. And you embrace the occasion to depart. And that is why you had a work and you have to go. And that is why, because Bassanio is here, you want to go. Good morrow, Salarino says, good morrow, my good lords. Good morrow means good morning. Bassanio, good sinners both, when shall we laugh? What do you mean by when shall we laugh? That means when do we have time to go to some party? When do we have to time to entertain ourselves? Say when. You grow exceeding strange. Exceeding strange means we haven't partied for long. We haven't enjoyed or entertained ourselves for long. Must it be so? Should it be so? We must plan for something to entertain ourselves. Bassanio is a person who is always, from here only you get this hint that Bassanio is a person who is a spendthrift, always waiting to spend money here and there. Okay, so now he wants to party. Salarino, we will make our leisures to attend on yours. Exit Salarino and Salanio. So he says that whenever you have time, you tell me, we will be surely present at your party. So what does Lorenzo say? Lorenzo says that, my lord Bassanio, since you have found Antonio, you have found your best friend, we too will leave you. That means I and Cristiano, that means Lorenzo himself and Cristiano will leave them. But at dinner time, during dinner, I pray you have in mind, that means do not forget, remember where we must meet. We have already planned to meet in dinner time, so please do not forget about that. Bassanio, I will not fail you. So Bassanio promises that no, he will not forget about dinner time. Cristiano, you look not well, Signor Antonio. You have too much respect upon the world. That means you are thinking about the worldly affairs. You are worried about a lot of things of the world, isn't it? You have to think so much about the world, and they lose it that do buy it with much care. If you constantly think about the problems and problems and problems, if you do not search for happiness, you will never be happy. Believe me, you are marvelously changed. You have changed a lot. You have become so sad and depressed. What is the reason? Do not worry yourself so much. Now, Antonio, I hold the world but as the world, Cristiano. That means I do not overthink about the world. I'm not thinking much about my problems. A stage where every man must play a part and mine a sad one. This part is very, very important. Remember, Shakespeare often compares the world with a stage. Over here also, Antonio compares the world with a stage. Why is it a stage? See, on a stage, characters get up to play their roles. In the same way, the human beings come in the world to play their roles. Okay, they have particular roles. Maybe somebody plays the role of a comedian, somebody plays the role of a hero, somebody plays the role of a jester, who is a comedian. Then somebody has to play the sad part also, or the villain's part also. Similarly, Antonio says that he is in the world to play the sad part. That means it is his normal nature. He is always so morose and depressed. That is his common nature. Okay, so we'll keep up to this, and in the next class we will continue the next part of Act 1, Scene 1, and I guess we will be able to complete in the next class only the second part of Act 1, Scene 1, and then we will move on to the rest. I hope this part is clear to you all. If you have any problem, you can write in the comment section. And if you have liked my video, please comment and subscribe, and also share it with your friends. Thank you.